forgiveness in marriage. How can we bring about marriages where forgiveness is a way of life?
You're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the podcast ministry of True Parents Way.
I'm your host, Tyler Hendricks, here with our co-host, Pastor Ruth Mwanda, welcoming you to a beautiful new week, and we're so grateful to be with you. But I just want to get right into the topic matter at hand. Jesus said to forgive in the Lord's Prayer, as a matter of fact. Jesus said, forgive our debts as we forgive our debtors, is what Jesus said in Matthew 6:12. So if it's in the Lord's Prayer, forgiveness is pretty important. And it wasn't at the very end of the prayer, it's before the end. But then, after Jesus finished his prayer, he goes back and he talks a little bit more about forgiveness. He gives a little gloss on it. And that'll lead us into this morning's prayer of Pastor Ruth. He said, if you forgive others their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will forgive you. So that actually makes forgiveness something magical. Do you want to be forgiven by God? You know what release and liberation and freedom we get when we're forgiven, right? That's all what Christianity is all about. My sins are forgiven. But Jesus didn't say, oh, if you believe in me, your sins will be forgiven. He said, if you forgive others, your sins will be forgiven. And he goes on. And he said, if you don't forgive others, your Heavenly Father will not forgive you. So this is a teaching that applies totally to marriage. If we want to have a beautiful marriage, forgiveness is the key. So our topic this week for Holy Marriage Blessing is forgiveness in marriage. And with that, I want to invite our co-host, Pastor Ruth Mwanda, to offer our opening prayer. Pastor Ruth.
Let us pray. Good morning, our dear most and beloved loving heavenly parent, true parent of heaven and earth and mankind, our beloved Lord Jesus, and all saints and sages, we come before you this morning with hearts full of gratitude and thanksgiving unto you, Father, for giving us this beautiful day, and that we can come before you, Heavenly Father, in worship and praise. Father, as we glorify and exalt your name, Father, that you have given us this day, Father, a warm day, Heavenly Father, which is an expression of your love and beauty to us. And Father, we want to invite you this morning as we share your words, Heavenly Father, that you can inspire us, you can build us, you can uplift us, Heavenly Father, with your words. That Father, as we grow in your word and mature in your word, that Father, we can become objects of your heart and love. And that Father, out of our deeds, Heavenly Father, we can give you joy. Father, as our parent, Father, we know that you desired, Heavenly Father, to live with your children. But Father, because of the fall, this never took place, and you have lived in loneliness. But Father, the time has come, Heavenly Father, where you are recreating us, and Heavenly Father, bringing us into your embrace. Father, we invite you to be with us as we share, Father, this very important topic of forgiveness, Father, in marriage. Heavenly Father, we know that many a times, Father, we do not live in accordance to your standard. And Father, therefore, we always come to you, Heavenly Father, for forgiveness. Help us also to do the same, Heavenly Father, in our homes, in our marriages, with our children, so that, Heavenly Father, we can bring about peace, Heavenly Father, wherever we are. Father, we invite you to be with us and share with us, Father, this moment. We thank you and love you, and we offer all this prayer humbly. In the name of the Lord. Amen.
Thank you so much, Pastor Ruth, for your wonderful prayer. We begin this week in prayer. We begin each service in prayer. We begin each day in prayer because we just need to be there with God, even just a small offering, a small recognition of God makes such a difference. So I'm very grateful for the chance to pray and to pray representing the internet, representing the world, everyone who's listening to this program, in the name of the Lord, in the name of the true parents, called by Jesus and led by the Holy Spirit, Bible-based, offering our prayer and our heart to God. Our topic is forgiveness in marriage. Pastor Ruth is going to read some passages, some selections from the words of Father Moon and Mother Moon, who together as true parents bring forgiveness of sin into marriage. We are forgiven not just of our individual sins as a child or son or daughter of God, brother or sister. We are forgiven of the sin of Adam and Eve who fell as a man-woman couple. We are forgiven of the original sin. We are forgiven of the sin that infects, honestly, every marriage, every man-woman relationship, with lust, with greed, with selfishness, with fear and shame and guilt, and prevents God from being fully present. Through the holy marriage blessing given by true parents on the foundation of the cross and their blood and sweat and tears, God is fully present in our marriage. And we can just wipe away the dust and the dirt of our own fallen nature. And one of the major steps to do that is forgiveness. So I want to pass the mic back to Pastor Ruth to share with us our teachings this morning on the topic of forgiveness.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hendricks. Our topic, as Dr. Hendricks have just mentioned, is about spiritual guidance on repentance and forgiveness by our true father, given in 1989. And I'll read. Do you embrace good and bad together? When you have the spark of true love, it melts and purifies all evil things. Jesus told us to love our enemies. He forgave the Roman soldiers who hung him on the cross. But would you do the same? If you were treated so evilly by someone, would you forgive him? This is the secret. When the evil is forgiven and embraced, it is eventually melted and purified. When you embrace your enemy, the spark of love of God will melt away evil. Even Satan cannot help but surrender in front of true love of God. When you are giving the true love of God, the smallest woman should feel, my love can melt even the biggest man. That is the kind of confidence you should have. That is the way I live my life. I want to embrace the entire world and every kind of person, even the most disagreeable one. How many of you have really walked down the street in the heart of God? And how many tears did you shed on behalf of God? Someone might mistreat you, but forgive them and come back with hope. Next time you visit him, you can have hope that he will be a new man and treat you differently. You are always being deceived by people, but always be their friend anyway. Even though you are always being deceived, people will become different with time. Now that the power of God is there, that God is not leaving you alone, If you have that much of forgiveness and generosity and prayer, but still the other person doesn't repent, then don't worry about him. Spirit world will come down and chastise him. Jesus was crucified on the cross. However, he dramatically demonstrated his love for humanity by forgiving and loving his own enemies. That deed made him a victor of love. Love conquers all, and nothing can displace it or overthrow it. Once you occupy this highest pinnacle of love, no one can topple you. When people argue about something, you have to embrace them with the power of love. You have to face your opponent and forgive them so that your own repentance will be actualized and you can bring these people to God. Patience can be the motivation of recreation and restart. When you are patient, you can forgive your enemy or your spouse. By forgiving your spouse, you can occupy him. The wrongdoer will draw a line between you and him. If you keep standing on the other side, there will always be a gap there. But if you step to his side to embrace him, then he will either retreat or be embraced by you. By your forgiving him and embracing him, you can occupy him. If a friend or even a spouse commits any mistake, you must feel like forgiving him, saying to yourself that it is my responsibility to have let him or her do that. Every sin, every mistake of theirs is nothing if you take the responsibility for it. On the other hand, those who sinned or committed mistakes must be frank in confessing their sins and mistakes. Do you understand what I mean? From this viewpoint, you must criticize and analyze yourself. That is a great thing, and this is the knack of how to become a good-like man. If you claim to be a good person, but once you commit some kind of mistake, you must beg for forgiveness from the other person you have wronged and from those associated with him. Otherwise, you will not be forgiven. If you just bury some anger in your heart without apologizing and speaking out to resolve it, then it will multiply as resentment and remain with you forever. In every area of human relationship, you must not try to cover everything over and persevere with resentment still growing in your heart. You must take it out and analyze it, and one of the two must apologize to the other and make some compensation. The leader who says that his members are not good is not a good leader. Nor are the members who say that their leader is not good. It is the same with a relationship between a husband and wife. Nothing is worse than a husband speaking ill of his wife or a wife speaking ill of her husband. When a spouse says that his wife or husband is bad, he is proving that he is as bad as well in front of God and true parents. When people judge their enemy in this world, they do so with hatred and power. We judge them by serving them and God more and more. That is the difference. We must have more love for God and the people and serve them instead of hating. And may God bless these words. And you're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, the Ministry of the Unification Families of Kingston. And I'd just like us to have a brief summary of our reading. and reflection. Many a times, conflicts in marriage begin because of selfishness. When one does not recognize their mistake, then anger and resentment come in and build up. If the mistake or the problem is not resolved, then the gap and tension continues until one cannot bear it anymore. From our readings today, we learn that we have to forgive. Ask for forgiveness when you are wrong or when you wrong each other. If you speak ill of your spouse, then you are not good either. Patience can be the motivation of recreating and restarting again. Forgive and forget and start anew and be born again and again in your marriage and do not repeat the same mistakes. Pray for one another and let love grow in you because it overcomes everything. And may God bless you all.
Thank you so much, Pastor Ruth, for sharing Father Moon's teachings that are Bible-based, that are based on the teaching and truth and of all the world's religions and really of common sense. Just live a virtuous life, which means to, you know, look at yourself first. If Father said, if the wife says her husband is no good, you know, it's like the mirror, it bounces right back. And if the husband says his wife has some problem, he's saying that he has a problem because they become one person in marriage. From God's point of view, from the point of view of nature, they're one person. And what God has made one, let no woman cast asunder. The first person, the first two people to whom that commandment from Jesus applies are the husband and wife themselves. Let no one, including the husband, including the wife, cast that asunder. But that means you take responsibility for goodness. For your strength is not for hurting. Your beauty is not for seducing. Your strength and your beauty are for the sake of God, for the sake of your children, for the sake of your society and your world, for the sake of love itself. Forgiveness in marriage. Now I want to share a little bit more on this topic of forgiveness in marriage. A good friend of ours, Reverend David Stewart from Toronto, intoned an important, a memorable saying a few months ago in a message that he gave. He said, in the Old Testament, it says, kill your enemy. You know, Moses said, kill your enemy. Jesus said, love your enemy. Reverend Moon says, marry your enemy. This is it's sort of humorous, but it does cut to the chase of what's going on here. Because of the fall, the world came to have enemy relationships. And it begins with enemy relationship between man and woman. From the viewpoint of God's plan for total oneness, total freedom, total goodness of man, woman, and love in marriage, the divorce rate is skyrocketing. Many young people don't even want to get married, cohabiting, having sex with no commitment. This is enemy relationships. You become enemies to each other. So to marry your enemy means that you're going to put all of that behind and you're going to establish a true love relationship. And who is your enemy? Is someone, if you're a black person, it's a white person. White person, black. If it's your Tibetan, it's Chinese. Chinese, it's Tibetan. If it's... Jew, it's Muslim. If it's Muslim, it's a Jew. These are enemy lines, enemy barriers. It could be your next door neighbor. Could be someone down the street. Marry your daughters and sons together with each other. That's true parents formula. By the power of love, God's love, and the true love of husband and wife, true husband and wife, is a love that overcomes all those enemy relationships that are not from God. They are from Satan. They are from fallen human beings. They are not eternal. They are temporary. Temporary means they're going to end. Let's end them right now through the holy marriage blessing and bring world peace through ideal families. I want to talk for a minute more about divorce, because, you know, if there's no forgiveness, what do you end up with? You end up with divorce. And divorce is, there's something called in our society, no-fault divorce. Was it always like that? No-fault divorce means, before no-fault divorce, in order to get divorced, there had to be a cause. For example, adultery. My spouse committed adultery. That is a cause that justifies divorce. Or my spouse is beating me, abusing me. That's a cause that justifies divorce. It's their fault. But once they started in California in the 1970s, I believe. Let me go back. You know where no-fault divorce began? It began with the Bolshevik Revolution in Russia in 1917. And they found that they let people divorce. They wanted people to divorce. They wanted families to end. They wanted to break down the family. That was their purpose. So they made divorce completely easy. The state paid for abortions. Even as the number of vagrant and homeless children multiplied, it was easy to get divorce. Free love was the slogan of Bolshevik Russia in the 20s. Now listen to this. By the 1930s, Soviet leaders, and I'm quoting from an article in the Family in America Journal written by Ryan McPherson, Soviet leaders realized that the children of the new postmarital generation lacked the kind of socializing experiences that would prepare them for successful adult life. Neither schools nor other public institutions could fill the gap where the family once had nurtured the young. And so in the 1940s, the communist government of Russia reinstituted marriage laws, and made it very difficult to get a divorce. They realized that divorce, that the breakdown of family, breakdown of marriage, breaks everything down, and they turned it around. Now, what's happening in America today in slow-mo is exactly what the communists did in Russia under Lenin in the late, just before around 1920. Let everybody get a divorce, and it's called no-fault divorce. And it has brainwashed our society so much that, again, according to this article, even the pro-family movement of the 1970s and 1980s was, quote-unquote, virtually silent about divorce. The moral majority was virtually silent about divorce. Standard histories of Jerry Falwell's movement, do not even list divorce on the index. Pat Robertson, great pro-family, pro-God, Christian leader of America, did not attack divorce. The Christian Coalition of Ralph Reed seldom addressed divorce. Of organizations that tout the benefits of marriage barely mention divorce. In fact, the divorce rate is higher in red states than in blue states. Conservatives tend to get divorced more than liberals. And now there's more to the story than that, but this is just in terms of divorce rate. In 1979, now the no-fault divorce entered into the picture in the late 60s, early 70s. By 1979, the New York Times published a 10-year retrospective on California's no-fault divorce law, and they found that men, women, and children each had suffered harm. Women, they quote, I quote, were better off under the adversary system because they used to get the home, furniture, and car. For older women, no-fault divorce has been a disaster. But the, and the statistics are incredible. And the ones who suffer the most from no-fault divorce are not the older women, are not the men, but it is the children. Children suffer most of all. We have to take marriage very more seriously. There are rights and wrongs. There are rules. There are standards for marriage. And the society, beginning with parents and schools and churches and synagogues and mosques, have to educate the young people to prepare our children to be mature enough to enter into marriage relationships. We need a responsible marriage relationship. We need institutions of society to support marriage, culture to support marriage, and to end divorce. For that, we need to create a culture of forgiveness. We all make mistakes. Husbands make mistakes. Wives make mistakes all the time, not just once in a while, all the time. We have to learn how to forgive. Because when we forgive, God will forgive us. When God forgives me, then I have the power to embrace my wife, to renew that relationship. That's what a marriage is. There's no trace of it. Forgive and forget. You literally forget what the problem was. Don't cling to it, as Reverend Moon said. If you cling to that, whatever you felt wronged you, that resentment just builds and builds inside of you, and it ruins your health. It ruins your happiness. Much less ruins your marriage. Forgive fully and sincerely. Give your love. Just keep giving love. And forget and give more love. We invite you to receive this holy marriage blessing that gives us the grace, through the love of God in true parents, on the foundation of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit, and the biblical prophets and saints, to create ideal families that are the foundation for world peace.
You're listening to Holy Marriage Blessing, podcast ministry of True Parents Way. I'm Tyler Hendricks. I'm really grateful for our co-host, Pastor Ruth Mwanda. Thank you, Ruth, for sharing with us. Our music is by Ronan Hardiman. And until next week, we see you next week. We're with you again next week, every week. God bless you. Love God, share the blessing, and don't give up.